I'm Rick Emerson, and welcome back to Outlook Portland on Portland CW. Was there a moment that crystallized the fact that you wanted to be a writer? Was there a book or an author, something you read that sparked it, where you said, that's what I want to do?
When I read Bridget Jones's diary, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah, and I just thought, there needs to be a boy Bridget Jones. It just seemed like the book that I wish I had written, except that I wanted it to be a guy. And that just sort of first-person neurotic was really intriguing to me. And that was the moment where I said, at that point I was already a writer, I was already a columnist, but that was the moment where I said, I gotta write a book. Like, I can't not write a book any longer. If this woman can write this book, then I'm gonna have to write my book. And that's when I wrote How I Paid for College. And I was working a day job when I wrote that.
What was it about? Was it the language? Was it the bent of the character? What was it about Bridget Jones' Diary, which is a fantastic
It's the character.
Work.
I think it's the fact that it's a comic novel, and comic novels weren't really in vogue. They had gone out of vogue. It was, you know, they were very popular in the 40s and 50s and 60s, and then they kind of disappeared. And oddly enough, it was Auntie Mame that sold my book. When my book came across my editor's desk, they had recently reissued Auntie Mame through my publisher. And my publisher looked at my book and he said, you know, there's something very Patrick Dennis-y about this. There's something very Auntie Mame-ish about this humor. And we just reissued that, and it had done really well. And they thought, maybe the market is ready again for comic novels. And so I managed to ride, you know, Auntie Mame's coattails, oddly enough. It was a weird, you know, intersection that I never in a million years would have guessed would have happened.
And you just, in the last few minutes, we've talked about Chuck Palahniuk, yourself, Storm Large, Courtney Hameister, who's an incredibly funny person, just really an amazingly talented writer herself.
It seems. And a wearer of sparkly dresses, too, we should just add. She does sparkle.
I think she's been on this program, she's been on this show, and I think she's been on my radio show at least once, maybe twice, mm-hmm. And I always feel so painfully bland and uninteresting. Because she just has so much sort of vibrancy in mm-hmm. her comedy, and it does seem like Portland is one of those places that's always about to be discovered for
yeah.
this reason, because there's going to be a critical mass, and everybody will look and they'll go, aha, Portland, but it doesn't quite ever seem to happen. So will it, and if it does, would that in some ways be bad for Portland, do you think?
Wow, what a question. I ponder that same thing. I don't have an answer to that. I'm sorry. I wish I had sort of a quippy answer to that, but it's, we, you know, we're definitely coming into our own, and it's coming from the ground up, because it's very much a do-it-yourself kind of environment. But I just don't know whether. What do you think? I wish I had an answer to that. What do you?
That sort of seems to be a random. It seems to be a random turn of the wheel, as it does with music, where, you know, it's Minneapolis and then it's Detroit and then it's Seattle and, you know, then it's somewhere else. And so it does seem a little unpredictable. I think that the spotlight probably does bring as many negatives as positives. But that being said,
you know, I think you're right. I think if you look at the places that it happened in, there's certainly always that feeling that we could be sort of Paris in the 20s. But that said, you can't really engineer that. That's a perfect storm. And those things happen because they happen. And when you look back retrospectively, there's always some kind of oddball reason, and I can't think of an example of why, but, you know, there's, the reason Impressionism started was because you could finally put paint in tubes, and then artists could go outdoors and they could paint outdoors, and at the same time there was photography, in which case they didn't want to paint things in a realistic way. I think that's the kind of way these things happen, artistic movements happen, and it's only in retrospect you can go, oh yes, it was because of the massive migration of whatever.
What seems so clear retrospectively.
Yeah, and I just don't know when you're in it that you can, and I don't think you can engineer it either.
As Aerosmith's Steven Tyler would say, when you're in the painting, man, you can't see the painting.
So oh, that's
right
deep.
Now, we are in the painting.
Absolutely.
Archaeologists of the future will describe the painting for us. As we plummet toward the finish line, is there anything you wish to relentlessly self-promote?
I think we're pretty good, actually. I think we managed to get in both books, How I Paid for College, Attack of the Theater People, the play next season, an artist rep, listen to me on NPR. I think I feel complete here.
All that in snakeskin shoes as well.
Size 9. It's the sample size thing.
Marc Acito, thank you so much for joining us. My name is Rick Emerson. If you find me at all moderately amusing, you can hear me mornings 5 to 9 on Rock 101 KUFO right here in Portland. Insert trademark catchphrase here. We'll see you next time right here on Outlook Portland on Portland CW.